Hi everybody, welcome back. Let's continue talking about Pearson's R. This will be the last video that we have about the correlation coefficient. And then we'll talk about how we can extend our conversation and we can use these correlations to conduct a regression analysis. That's in the next chapter. First though, let's talk about some important issues that can affect that Pearson correlation. Outliers are an important thing that can affect a correlation coefficient, particularly if the sample size is relatively small. Remember, when the sample size is small, one outlier can really have an effect on all of that data. Check out this situation. Scatter plots can work really well just to get a sense of what your data looks like. In this situation, it looks like we have almost no correlation. And in fact, if we were to crunch those numbers, we would find a correlation coefficient pretty close to zero, negative 0.08. Now look at what happens right over here. All I do is add one more data point. When we add that one data point, now it looks like there is a relationship between the variables. You can see this one data point is having quite an influence, more of an influence than one data point really should have. And when we crunch those numbers, now it shows a correlation coefficient, which is very strong, a positive 0.85. So scatterplots serve as very good diagnostic tools. If we were to create a scatterplot and take a look, we would know that we have an outlier, and that one outlier is going to have a very strong influence on our results. In these situations, statisticians are very leery to conclude that there's a strong positive correlation because of that one case. Another issue that affects correlations is known as restricted range, and restricted range can lead to type 1 and type 2 errors, and I'm going to explain that in just a second. It's really mostly a research design issue, because restricted range has to do with who you're actually studying, who you're measuring. And instead of getting a good representative sample from the entire population, sometimes your sample might be restricted such that only some people, some certain segment of that population is being measured. Let me give you an example. So let's say that on our x-axis we have high school GPA, and on our y-axis we have college GPA. And there is indeed a positive correlation between those two variables. We can see a trend here. But let's say that has not been demonstrated previously, and I'm interested in studying those two variables. And let's further assume that I work at a school like Harvard, where all of the students coming in have very high school GPAs. And in general, students who get admitted into Harvard, they do well at school at Harvard as well. So they're successful in high school and they're successful in college. So if I'm only measuring these students right here, I'm gonna find students who have high school GPAs and also high college GPAs. And it might look like there's no relationship between those two variables, when across the entire population, there clearly is a trend to the data. There clearly is a correlation. Do you see how that's a problem? Because the range of people who I measured within that population was restricted to just people on the high end. So that's likely to lead to a type 2 error, where I conclude there's no relationship between high school and college GPA, where indeed, across the entire population, there is a relationship between those two variables. Of course, the opposite type of thing could occur as well. If I'm studying and measuring just a restricted range from that population, I might find a relationship among those people, but if I were to measure the entire population, there might not be any pattern to the results at all. There might not be any relationship between the two variables. So that would be a type 1 error. I'd be saying a relationship exists across the entire population, and I would be wrong. Let's talk about a couple other important issues affecting the Pearson's R. When we compute a correlation analysis, we're just checking to see if there's a relationship between the two variables. It's a research design issue that allows us to say if we have a causal relationship between two variables. And we know that a correlational research design cannot lead to a causal explanation. And that's primarily because correlational research designs are not well controlled. So when we do find a relationship, and here there's a relatively strong relationship between these two variables, when we find a relationship like this, it doesn't mean it's a causal relationship. This is the relationship between the number of churches in a city or town and the number of serious crimes in those cities and towns. And you can see this is a positive relationship, a strong positive relationship. The nature of that relationship suggests that the more churches you have in a city or town, the more crime you have in some city or town. And someone might want to conclude that churches or religion causes crime. And that would probably be an inappropriate conclusion. Remember, correlation doesn't prove causation. Give some thought as to why you think we might find that relationship. We would indeed, in the real world, find a relationship like that. It's probably because there's some third variable, some other variable that's driving that relationship right there. So some variable that we did not control. As we go through each of these examples, remember we keep trying to fit a line to our data, a straight line to our data. I'm trying to draw a best fitting line that comes as close to as many data points as possible. So in other words, when we do a correlational analysis or a regression analysis coming up, we are trying to fit a straight line to our data. And that's what correlation is all about. It's about assessing linear relationships between variables. So another factor affecting Pearson's R is that it's only appropriate for assessing linear relationships. This right here is not a linear relationship. Some people would call this a curvilinear relationship. This right here is a relationship between two variables, one being the amount of practice you have, and the other being your level of performance. And when you're learning some new task, typically you start performing better pretty quickly. I mean, because you didn't know anything at first, and then pretty quickly you're picking things up. But then at some point, your performance starts to level out, and it takes really then a long time for you to show more gains. If we tried to crunch these numbers with a correlational analysis, a typical Pearson's R, we'd be trying to fit a straight line to that data. That would be inappropriate. So again, it's smart to look at those scatter plots and figure out what kind of data you have. And if the data is, in general, linearly related, then it's appropriate to do the Pearson's R correlational analysis. Not only does the Pearson's R assess linear relationships between variables, but those variables need to be continuous in nature and measured on an interval or a ratio level scale. There are alternatives to the Pearson's correlation when we have different types of data measured on different scales. We in our class do not compute these alternative correlation coefficients, but we like you to be familiar with the alternatives that exist. One reason that we don't spend time computing these alternative correlation coefficients is because they actually use the same formula that we just learned for the Pearson's R, so there's nothing new. It's just that sometimes we need to do something to the data before we do the analysis. And right here with the Spearman's R, this is a good example of that. You'll understand what I mean in just a minute. First of all, the Spearman's R is often denoted with an R and a little sub S for Spearman. You might encounter these every now and then when you're looking at journal articles. When we have data that is somewhat non-linear, what we can analyze is the ranked data. So I mentioned sometimes we need to do something first to the data when we're doing one of these alternative correlation coefficients. So instead of actually crunching the actual data values, first we rank these data points. So first, just like look at the x-axis here. Do you see how person B here has the lowest value? And then person D and person A and person C. So we'd give this person a rank of 1, this person a rank of 2, 3, and 4 on that x variable. That's what I mean by ranking the data. And then the same thing for the y variable. This person, again, has the lowest value on the y variable. This person the second lowest. So we'd give this person a rank of a 1, a rank of a 2, a rank of a 3, and a rank of a 4 for the y variable. And at this point, what we do is we compute a correlation of those ranks. And here you can see a scatter plot of those ranks. And do you see how when we're looking at that ranked data, because there was a consistent relationship between these two variables, every time there was an increase in an x value, there was an associated increase in the y value. Whenever that's the case, we'll have essentially a perfect linear relationship. So it's one way to deal with data that's not linearly related. In addition to that Spearman's R, there are other popular alternatives to the Pearson correlation coefficient. One is called a point biserial correlation, and the symbol that's used there is the R with a PB for point biserial. And another is known as the phi or phi coefficient. Not everybody pronounces that word the same way. It's a Greek word, of course. It's a Greek letter. I was taught to pronounce it phi. I know a lot of people pronounce it phi. Doesn't matter either way. This is the symbol for it. But this table might help you understand when we would use these alternatives. Keep in mind, sometimes we have continuous data. When we have continuous data, we do the Pearson correlation coefficient. Sometimes we have ranked data, like we just talked about, and then we do the Spearman correlation coefficient. Sometimes our data is dichotomous. What I mean by dichotomous is that people essentially fall into one category or another, and that data does not necessarily even need to be quantitative. So like someone's a male or a female, someone graduated from college or they didn't graduate from college, something like that. This table, if you look through it, it helps you understand when to use each of these alternative correlations. So for example, let's run through a couple examples. And I have some examples here also of the different types of data. If we're measuring a continuous variable, we're looking at something like age or GPA or credit hours. Remember, we're talking about a continuous number line. So someone can be 10 years old, 11 years old, 12 years old, or any point in between. It's a continuous number line. Here are dichotomous variables, like I told you about before. Here's ranked data. You're either a freshman, a sophomore, a junior, a senior. You see how I can rank those in a meaningful way? Or I might try to categorize people based on the decade that they're in terms of their age. Are they in their 20s, their 30s, their 40s? That's ranked data. So let's say we have one variable that's continuous, and then our second variable is continuous as well. Let's see where those converge. They converge right here on the Pearson correlation. Well, we knew that. That's what we just spent quite a bit of time practicing. Let's say I'm trying to determine if there's a relationship between a person's sex, male or female, and whether they graduated or not from college. So I have two dichotomous variables, dichotomous on the X variable, dichotomous on the Y variable. Where do they converge? Right here, the phi coefficient. So that phi coefficient is used to see if there's a relationship between two dichotomous variables. Let's say I've got one variable that's continuous, like the person's age, and another that is dichotomous, whether they graduated or not. So I might be looking to see if there's a relationship between younger people and older people, so in other words, their age, to see if eventually they graduated or not from college. You know, sometimes older students have just more they need to deal with, like a family and a job, compared to younger students. My experience is that older students usually do better than the younger students. Bottom line is it would be an interesting thing to measure. So I have one variable that's continuous. We're looking at the person's age. And I have one variable that's dichotomous. We're looking to see if they graduated or not. If I have a dichotomous variable and a continuous variable, they converge right here. And it's telling me via this table that I would need to compute a point biserial correlation. So the table's helpful. Try to be familiar with the different alternatives to the Pearson's correlation. We do not need to actually compute those, but we should be somewhat familiar that they exist and when we would use them. So we've just learned quite a bit about correlations. What we're going to do in the next chapter is take everything that we learned about correlations and extend that into a regression analysis. I'll see you in the next video.